this video, we're going to show you how to open a new client, property, and claim in ClaimWizard. We're also going to show you how to search and add information to an existing client, property, or claim when you need to add an additional property or claim to a client. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do here is show you fast entry. So up in the upper right-hand corner, you will see a fast entry button. If you do not see this button, that means that you don't have sufficient security clearance to what we call originate a new claim in ClaimWizard. By default, out of the box, office staff do have the ability to originate a new claim in ClaimWizard, and assignable users do not. If you feel that you need this ability, contact your management staff at your company and they can contact us to make that change, or they can make the change themselves. So if you are opening a brand new client, property, and signed contract claim on a new piece of work that you've got, you can click the fast entry button. What this is going to do is this is going to walk you through the system. It's going to ask you very specific questions. You don't have to answer them all. Very little information is actually needed to open a new client, property, and claim within ClaimWizard. We would much rather you have limited information in the system so that you can start tracking deadlines and sending paperwork and compiling a case rather than it sitting on your desk and having you miss deadlines. So in ClaimWizard, there's generally two ways that you can classify a claimant type. It's either individual or organization. We can take anything pretty much you can throw at us. The only difference here is individual requires you can see the red asterisk, to have a first and last name. And then if it's a business holder, if applicable, versus an organization name, which requires you not to have a first and last name, but just a business name. So we are going to say, is this contact a policy holder? Yes or no, but it defaults to yes. You can enter in the name and just go on with your day. So one of the rules again with ClaimWizard, if you don't see something, scroll, because we never know how big your web browser screen is. So you can enter in whatever information you want here, scroll down and hit the next button. Here, we're going to ask you for a loss address name. And if you hover over the info card, it's going to just tell you kind of what we're looking for. Basically, in ClaimWizard, we need something to click on. So this could be home address. This could be their street address, which is fairly common. So you may say 1366 Main Street, etc., even though that's a different physical address. Now, property type is up to you. All this information helps, especially when you are generating documentation out of the system. So it might be however you choose to describe the property type. Now, is loss address the same as clients? We will say yes, and we will automatically populate that from the screen before. But if the loss address is not the same as the clients, and many times this is the case specifically in commercial claims, you can slide this to no. And the loss details, this is the actual loss address where the peril occurred. The claimant information may have different mailing address, etc. You can leave that, it will carry it forward. Now, loss claim or loss address name is required, like I said, because we just need something to click on in ClaimWizard, but all of the rest of this is optional. If you scroll down here, reason for claim, it will default to new claim, but just know that what you pick here is why you're opening the claim. It doesn't matter what the claim winds up being in the middle or the end of the process of running the job, but the reason why you're opening the claim. Now, most cases it will be new claim, but maybe you're just doing contents adjusting on it, or you're only doing a BI claim on it. I would pick whatever is applicable in the situation. Reopen supplemental, obviously very popular. But when you pick this reason for claim, this determines the action item workflow that you will execute. So we're going to cover that more in a different video. But just so you know, if you open a claim and you don't see the action items that you expect to see it, it's because the action item reason for claim workflow has not been populated. So we will definitely cover that in another video. But just know that this needs to be here. Of course, you may not actually know the date of loss yet, the cause of peril. You may still be, try to investigate that, etc. All of this information is here for you to pick. If it's a FEMA claim, yes or no. Is it habitable? Yes or no. Is it state of emergency? Yes or no. Is it related to, so whatever you want to do, and this can be a free form field here for name of hurricane, storm, or other significant event. This enables you to search and compile your claim work together. Just because something happened in a specific area on a specific date doesn't necessarily mean it's related to a catastrophic event, etc. So then we're going to hit next. We're going to go up here. The last piece of required information is a contract date. If you do not have a signed contract with a policyholder, you do not yet legally have a client. So if you're unsure about the exact date of the contract signing, say in the instance of you drop a contract off on Friday and you pick it up on Monday from them, in theory, they could have signed it one of any 4 days, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, or Monday. I would put the sooner date in here. And if you get this back and you say, well, they actually signed it on the 13th, you can always modify this later. But without a contract date, it is not a claim for your company. So that's why we ask this. If they are a prospect, we can enter them in a different way. And it basically asks a much shorter subset of this information. Your claim fee type, of course, is listed on your contract. But if you choose not to put this in here, you don't have to. There may be fields that you do not know what they are. Google is your friend. And also fields that do not apply to your business, either for your business process or because of the state or the particular carrier or declaration page that you're working with. If you need to track things such as date and time of first contact, our thinking is do it now while you have the information fresh in your mind, because if you have to go back and recompile this information 16 months from now, it could be very difficult. We are big fans of when you have the data and touch the data, deal with it, and then you can go on with your day and forget about it. If you ever need this, it's there. If you don't, it took you 5 seconds to enter. Next one here is source of claim. So here is your referral sources, right? So did you get it from a company, your website, direct mail? You can scroll. There is an other at the bottom, and you can enter in whatever company that you want to. So you can put that in here. We also allow you to accept or cancel. So if you're accepting the claim, and that's why you're putting it in here, it will go in. But if you want to track this information just for your own knowledge, how many, what we would call a CWP, a canceled without pay. So you signed the contract, but you've decided that you're not going to go through with it. Or by the time you go to enter the information in Claim Wizard, your client has canceled the contract. That can be stated in here. Hit the next button. Insurance carrier information. If you have it, put it in. Otherwise, you can add it later. When you select your insurance company and put that information in here, that helps narrow down some further information later on down in you working with the claim, such as if you enter in Allstate as an insurance carrier, only Allstate employees will show up that you may have listed in the system. You have to enter it yourself. That only those people will be eligible to be assigned to the claim on the behalf of the client, right? So that you're going to understand, I have an Allstate claim, this is my desk examiner, this is my field adjuster, etc. We deal with IAs and TPAs in a slightly different manner, and we'll cover that in a different video. But here, if you want to select that, you can just do a type ahead, it will show you who you have, and it populates that information. If you have declaration page information, add it here. Of course, if you have additional coverages, dwelling limits, deductibles, etc., that can be entered in later in the claim. But right now, we're trying to do a fast entry, so we're going to ask for your A, B, C, D, and any other limits that you may have, including even listing your policy type and the policy category. Hit next. If you know of mortgage company, you can put it in here. Or if you were here and you're like, oh, I don't have that mortgage company yet, you can add it straight from here. Once you enter this, they will show up in your company section, which if you can see it's grayed out right now, it will be the two kind of index cards on your jump tabs. So if you wanted to enter this in, you could, and it would show up here. Otherwise, we're just going to cancel and skip it. This screen can be very important for you. You can assign unlimited amounts of people on a claim. They have to have assignable accounts in your system, so office staff are not eligible to be signed to a claim, and you can assign multiple people in the same type of role. So if you happen to have two adjusters, two estimators, what have you, you can assign them all. Right here in the quick entry, we only give you four options, but of course you can open up the claim after and add as many as you want. First, you select your role. So we're not going to, here we're going to assign adjuster, and these are the eligible adjusters in your company. So we're going to put Al as an adjuster. If we wanted to have another adjuster and I wanted to say Arthur was an adjuster, we could do that as well. If you have appraisers, apprentices, you would have to have them in the system. Here you can see the only apprentice we have is Roy. So we're going to give him that. And if I had a role that I do not use, such as cleaning technician, it would say no personnel available. Add any special comments or notes that you might want to and hit next. Now, remember we had those three people. We're going to go back here and we're going to say Al, Arthur, and Roy. Now remember them for a second. We're going to go forward to save and we're going to hit save. Immediately, I can tell you that those three people that were assigned to the claim have just been notified that they are assigned to a new claim. If they are using the desktop web application of ClaimWizard, it will show up on that front dashboard of theirs where it says newly assigned claims. You can see it grayed out in the past. If they are using the ClaimWizard mobile application, they will get a ding on their phone within seconds that say you have a new claim assigned to you. So at this point, you can go through and open the claim, or you can keep going in sequence and adding a new claim, and it will start the fast entry process all over again. If you are working on an existing property or client, you can very easily search up your property or client, add them from there. So what I'm going to show you is if I have a client named Smith, your search on the side will break them down. So these are your actual client slash policyholders, non-signing contacts they may have, and then existing claims and external companies, etc., that somehow are related to the word Smith. So what I'm going to do right here is I have this client, Joe and Jane Smith, and they currently have one property listed with us and one open claim. So I'm going to open up them, because if you have repeat clients, it's always, or have a tendency to have that in your business, it's always a good best practice to search for them so you're not adding duplicates. We do not check for duplicate client names because obviously there can be multiple people that exist on the planet with the same exact name. And what we're going to do is we're just going to break this down and show you how to edit their contact information. If they are a presumably married couple with the same last name, you can do Joe and Jane as a first name. That way it prints appropriately on your document templates. Here we're going to get some basic information on that client. We call it NAEP, name, address, phone, email address, as well as anything else that you might want, and some information that we can cover in another video. What you're really looking for here is to go to properties and clients. And you can see here we're in the client section. We lump clients and properties together because they are both unique entities that exist in the real world. Right, so we're going to see here properties and claims. This client has one property, we've nicknamed it home address, and one claim right here. And this is, we have no information for this yet, but this is where it is. So if you would like to edit this physical property, you can do so by hitting the edit button, change the type of home it is, it's a condominium, description of property, changes. So we have a lot of really good fields here so that, you know, if they put on a new roof and never adjusted their policy, you may want to note that here, etc. If you needed to add a new property, you can do that here. It is going to add, so maybe they have a vacation home and you're going to say it is a commercial condo because they rent it out every once in a while. Is it owner or tenant occupied, etc., occupancy type. You can figure out what makes most sense to you and save this. Now here we're going to have their vacation home listed. We have no information because I entered the bare bones to get it in. And we are going to have their home address. If you need to open a claim on their vacation home, you simply hit the add claim button and it will ask you a subset of that fast entry information. Reason for new claim, loss, peril, contract, etc. And then you can go through and do that. And when you get to the end, it will ask you to confirm. See, now it's telling me the contract field is required because you cannot have a client without a contract date. So we're going to forward date that. I'm going to close that. And now you can see on the vacation home, we have entered a brand new claim. It is in the sequence that is stated, the sequence number that is stated in here, as well as information. And you automatically immediately get an email address that you can email information into this claim. If you were looking to open another claim on home address, you would simply do the same. I'm just gonna kinda go through here and add some random information. Go to confirm, press save. And as you can see here on this particular home address on this physical property, we have two open claims in the system and one open claim on their vacation home. So of course, each claim is autonomous to itself. It can have, as long as it is the same physical piece of real estate, it can have a different carrier, a different peril, a different date. It operates completely on itself. And of course, to open it, you can click on that claim number. You will get the side view. Otherwise, you can click on the claim number and hold the Alt key down, and it will jump you directly to that brand new claim that we entered into the system and amend the tab to the open claims that we are already looking at in Claim Wizard.